Well, hey, good morning, Cathedral. How are you today?
Good.
You guys have a good Christmas? Good. We spend some time with family. My folks are here. And one of the things that tends to happen a lot when you get together with family is you start looking through like those old photo albums. Any of you do that over Christmas? It's a little bit scary, but it's kind of fun to see where you've come from. And just for fun, I have a couple of really bad pictures of me to show. So here's me. Look at this slugger. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, I think I struck out every game. All right. And there. Oh, great. Yeah. Uh-huh. There's. Oh, and man, I wish I still had that shirt. That's great. And then here's high school. This is hockey player skater Jeff. Wow, that hair. And then on to college with the bleach tips. I was the original JT. Just so you know, this is before Timberlake. I have no idea why I'm holding a cat. I can't stand cats. This shows the Lord's sanctification. This is my wife and I and our son Judah when he was, goodness, like 1.5 or something like that. So, and then this is me after running the Palooza last year. That's about how I felt. But one of the things that's so interesting when you look through some of these photos, you know, at every one of those stages, I thought of myself as mature, as having it together, of thinking that was a good hairstyle. But one thing's amazing is you begin to look back, you're like, what in the world was I thinking? You know, I'm sure I'll look back on this hairstyle and be like, what was the height with that? What is going on there? I'm sure it will be something bad later. But at each of those stages, we recognize our immaturity in the past and how I've got it so together today, right? But if logic would tell us, if we look back and see how immature we are in 10 years, when I look back at this hairstyle and I look back at my life now, I'll then see how immature I was, how far I still had to go in not just my hairstyle, but in following the Lord. And I believe that God's word wants to meet with every person in this room to help us take the next step of maturity that we need in 2020. Turn over in your Bibles to Philippians 3. We're going to start in verse 12 in just a moment. But as you're turning there, I want to give you a little context. Philippians is a book written by Paul. He's in a Roman prison at this point towards the end of his life. He loves the people of the church of Philippi. He's been a part of growing this church, and he's away from them, but he wants to give them some of these final instructions, tons about joy in this book. But Paul really loved these people. He considered them partners in the gospel work, was thankful that they had all done and really had hoped to get to see them again. As far as we know from history, he probably never did. But in chapter 3, just before our text that we're going to get to, he lists all of his accomplishments, his sort of spiritual resume, his pedigree, all of the great things about his background that many people from the day would have looked at and been like, wow, that guy's got it together. He's the person we want to be like. But he says, you know, all of this is how I thought I was supposed to get into heaven. It's how I thought I was supposed to be right with the Lord. But now I realize that all of my righteousness is garbage. He uses, actually, in the Greek, it's probably a worse word than that, but I won't use that in church, even though Paul did. But he says it's garbage, it's rubbish, it's worthless to me compared to knowing Jesus Christ my Lord. Paul trusts in the saving work of Jesus as his only means for salvation. It's by grace. It's through faith. It's not of works. It's not all of these things that he's done in the past. The great exchange happens of his sin for Jesus's righteousness. And for each of us, if you have turned from your sins and trusted Jesus by faith, then you have made that exchange with Jesus Christ. That all of your good, all of your bad from the past is wiped away, and his righteousness is yours. It's an amazing reality, and one that Paul leans into here. We trust on what Jesus has done in the past, and all of us are called to keep moving forward as we're seeking the Lord. Let's begin reading in verse 12. Philippians 3, 12 and following. Not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us who are mature think this way, And if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that to you also. Only let us hold true to what we have attained. He calls us to press on, to move forward. And as we lean into that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we're grateful for all that you've done in our midst. And as we look back over the past year, we are grateful for your faithfulness, your enduring love to us, way more than we could ask or imagine, because of your faithfulness, because of your goodness to us, Lord, and we worship you for that. But God, we don't want to settle for what you've done in the past or what you've done just even in this year in us. We want more ground for you. We want to see the enemy shriek back. We want to see greater victory in our lives. We want to see greater glory for you, Lord. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Paul calls us here to press on, to keep moving forward in our relationship with Jesus Christ, in our obedience, in our maturity. And he says first, to move forward, I'm not there yet. Move forward, I'm not there yet. I'll say these a couple times because you don't have any blanks to fill in, so you got to write a little more. We're making you work for it. It's the last one of 2019, so you got to write a little more. Move forward, I'm not there yet. He says in verse 12, not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Jesus Christ has made me his own. He says, I haven't arrived. I'm not there yet. I'm not made perfect. This, the word this and it actually aren't there in Greek, but Paul here is pointing back to what he's just stated. If you look up ahead in verse 10 and following, he says, that I may know him, know Jesus, and the power of his resurrection, that I may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible, I may obtain the resurrection from the dead. That's what he's pointing to. I haven't already accomplished all this. I'm not perfect. I'm not there yet. He says in verse 8, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. I count it as garbage compared to Jesus Christ. It doesn't matter how good you are, it's garbage. And it doesn't matter how much you feel like garbage because of the way you've lived. You're good because of Jesus Christ. He's declared you righteous. It's an incredible reality. We move forward to live our lives up to the standards of what Jesus modeled for us and who God declares us to be. He declares us to be righteous and to be holy. And because that's our identity, because we've been declared that, you've been forgiven of your sins and washed clean, you're blameless, you're holy. Now he calls us to live like that going forward in maturity. And that's what Paul is saying, that we're pressing on to do this. And look at the reason why in verse 12. He says, Christ Jesus has made me his own. Wow. Jesus has made me his own. Not just that he's taking care of my sin, because that's an incredible reality, but he's made you his own. You belong to Jesus Christ. He has bought you with his blood. No longer do we live in ransom to sin. We're not controlled by all of that. We're set free because we have a new master and his name is Jesus. You belong to him. He has made me his own. If it's true of you, say it with me. Jesus has made me his own. It's an incredible reality. Jesus has his grasp on you. You're saved. You're sealed. Your righteousness of Christ is yours. It's ours because of what Jesus Christ has done. And now we strive and press on towards greater Christian maturity. This is the term called sanctification. That's what Paul's talking about here, this pressing on to greater maturity because of what's already been done. It's beautiful too when you look at this text. Anybody remember Jesus' last word on the cross? It is finished. Tetelestai is actually the Greek word. It is finished. It's complete. It's perfect. It's done. Over. That's what Jesus says. Paul uses the exact same word here to say like, but I'm not done. It's just this beautiful reality that we see in God's word that it's an already and not yet dichotomy. That we've already been made right. We've already been forgiven. We already have a place in heaven with Jesus Christ. But in this life, while we're still on earth, we're still working out our salvation with fear and trembling. It's this process of sanctification where even though it's been completed for me, I have yet to receive the full completion of it. And that's what we're working on. And Paul's saying, I know that it's finished, but I'm not finished yet. I know that it's perfected, but I'm not perfected yet. I need to press on to greater Christian maturity. When I fail, I'm still his because it's perfect. It's completed. When I succeed, it's him working at me. I'm not there yet, and he's at work in my life. We move forward because Christ Jesus, the author of life itself, the one who stilled the storm, the one who multiplied the fish and the loaves to feed thousands of people, he's made us his own, and we belong to him. And because of that, Paul says, I press on. He says this twice in this passage. I press on to make this my own. He's emphasizing here the strenuous nature of this, that it's a battle, that it's a race, as we'll see in just a moment. The Christian life is supposed to be hard. So if you've had a tough year, it's supposed to be like that. It means that God is working in us. It means that he's using the circumstances of life to refine us, to complete us, to bring us to perfection. That's what he's talking about here. As we press on in this strenuous nature, it's supposed to be like this. So maybe there were some great joys in 2019 for you. Maybe you can look back and be like, man, that was a great week. That thing that God did, that was incredible. That victory in my life, that answered prayer that I saw, just praise the Lord for that. You should. We should be praising the Lord for all of those things. But maybe as you look back over 2019, you can look at some days and weeks and months and seasons and really the whole year that was painful. God, that hurt a lot more than I wanted it to. This is not what I envisioned when I stood on January 1st, 2019 and thought, what is the year gonna be like? I want it to be painful, Lord. I wanna have a lot of hardship. I wanna struggle a lot. None of us said that. But God's goodness is working through all of that. And although we're still waiting on some answers to prayer, although we're still hoping for some greater victory in some areas, he's not done yet. He's still at work in you. Press on. He has made you his own, and he's at work in you. We move forward by recognizing that we're not there yet, and we move forward toward the goal. We move forward toward the goal. He says, following in verse 13, brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. I love this. Paul's like a preacher here. This is like one of the churches that I lived in or grew up in. I remember the pastor would often say, you know, in conclusion, that meant he's got 20 minutes left, you know, like, right? Or you probably had professors who were like this last thing that's going to be on the test. And there's like the whole class is, you know, all about that. But Paul does that here. He does this like funny thing that preachers do. One thing I do. And then he tells them two things. You know, it's like the lettering, like number one and letter B and number three. You're like, wait, I've lost you here. But Paul says one thing I do, but he lists two things, but they're actually really one thing. If you look at him, he says, forgetting what lies behind. Now, just question for you. I didn't have time to study this week, but does he actually mean forget everything in the past? So clearly he wouldn't mean that. Why would he not say that? I mean, God's done some amazing things in our lives, and Paul wouldn't say for a minute that you should neglect, you should forget all of the amazing things that God has done. All throughout the Old Testament, we see, remember what God did. Set up these stones here so you remember and you can tell your kids about it and you all remember what God has done. So if we're told to remember, he clearly can't mean forget everything that God has done in the past. He clearly can't mean forget everything you've learned this year. What he actually means is it's a conscious refusal to let the memories of the past absorb his attention and impede his progress. It's a conscious refusal to let the memories of the past absorb his attention and impede his process. He's saying nothing that God's done in my life in the past, maybe this year, maybe this decade, nothing that God has done can mess up the fact that I've already possessed all that he desired for me, and I need to move forward to possess what he has for me this next year. He's saying all of the stuff in the past, good, bad, and otherwise, all of that has brought me to this point. And I'm not focusing on all that, the good stuff or the bad stuff. I'm not going to be tied up by all of that. I'm looking forward to the maturity that he has caused for me in this next year. It can't stop me from moving forward. But sometimes life tends to bring us to a bit of halt with things. So what halts us from moving forward? Here's a couple things. First, my past victory. This is primarily what Paul has in mind here. The good things in his past. He's not saying all of this stuff is bad. He's just saying it's garbage compared to Jesus. Sometimes we get tied up in the past victories, our big moments of your walk. This, man, the Lord did this great thing in my life 13 years ago, and I'm so grateful for it. Well, what have you been doing since then? Nothing. I'm just resting on the fact that he did that a long time ago. Now, it's not bad to celebrate your salvation or the things that he's done in the past, but that's not it. We're moving on to greater maturity. And sometimes the celebrating and the remembering and the nostalgia of the way that it used to be is the thing that can halt us from our growth in Christ. Sometimes these memories actually can hinder us. Give thanks to what God has done. Learn the lesson in what God has done in my life. Reload and press on. God is not done with you. If you are taking a breath, you have maturity in the future. So don't focus on the past victory. Paul didn't. Don't focus on past sins. You don't know what I've done. There's just too much wrong in my past. When we're forgiven, when Jesus Christ washes it clean, it says that he casts our sin as far as the east is from the west. It says that he blots it out, that he remembers it no more. It's the same thing. Do you think God doesn't remember my sin? No, he just chooses not to remember it, because when he looks at you, when he looks at me, when he looks at the sins that we have done, he sees the righteousness of Jesus Christ. You're perfect when God looks at you. And we live in congruence with that. He blots it out. He remembers it no more. Our past sins are just that. They're in the past. But then our past value. You know, the things of the Lord, they used to mean nothing to me. I spent so much time and so much energy chasing after and valuing things that don't matter in the grand scheme of eternity. And I can't ever get that time back. And we could spend a lot of time dwelling on all that, and it hinders us, it halts us from moving forward. But Joel 2:25 says, I will restore to you the years that the swarming locust has eaten. The things that you thought were gone, God will restore those things. God will use those seasons in your life to greater maturity. All that has happened, good and the bad, the Lord has used to bring you to this point, to press on to what's ahead for you in Jesus Christ. And then finally, our past lifestyle. You might be here today and you think, you know, my past just, it still haunts me. The shame, the guilt, and maybe you even have pictures in your mind that you feel like I can't get these images out of my head of the things that I've done, the way that I've lived. But look at Paul. This is a guy who went around with official letters to go kill Christians. That was his job. He was there at the stoning of Stephen, holding everybody's coats, watching as they put this faithful servant of the Lord to death in front of him, brutally. I would imagine that Paul still sees Stephen's face, that he still can remember the names of the people on his list. I'm going after this person. And then he remembers crossing them off. Paul remembered all of that. All of that was in his past. But he pushes past that. Jesus has paid for all of that. And it doesn't do to dwell on all of those things that I can't fix anymore, because Jesus Christ has fixed them. He's taken care of that. He's paid for those things. And now I press on to greater maturity. Don't allow these things to halt your forward growth. Don't allow them to halt you to keep moving forward for all that God would have for us. 2 Corinthians 5:17. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone. Behold, the new has come. New things are for you this year. We put the things of the past in the past, and we move forward to where God would have us. What is it that you need to leave behind? What do you need to lay at the foot of the cross today? Just in this room, before you walk out the door. I just got to leave that there. I got to leave that with the Lord. I got to forget that. I have to leave it in my past. You are not your past. You're not your past victory. You're not your past sins. You're not your past values. You're not your past lifestyle. Keep moving forward. Keep taking ground on the enemy. We are not done yet. God is still at work at us, and there's a goal in front of us that we're moving forward. We are to keep moving forward. And Paul refuses to look back. He refuses to let his past determine his forward momentum. Paul uses an analogy here of running. He uses a lot of analogies about running in his walk, and I don't know why, because running's stupid. It is. It's stupid. And I've been talked into running multiple marathons, and I was running yesterday thinking running is stupid. It is. But Paul uses that. One of the things that I actually love about running is the goal. I will not go out and, some of you are crazy. You'll go out and like, I'm gonna run 3 miles today. It's great. Why? Why do that? I have found I will only run if I have a goal. So I'm already registered and paid for 3 races for this next season. Because I know if I don't have a goal, I'm not running. I will sit on my rear end and watch golf. That's what I will do. But I know that I need to get out and run. So I'm gonna set a goal in front of him, in front of me. And Paul uses this sports analogy of running. The goal here, what he's talking about, it's actually the word for the finish line, the end of the race. And believe me, when you start some of those races, that's, you're just like, please, Lord, let it be over soon. I just want to be at the finish line. But that's what Paul's doing here. The goal is the finish line. He sees himself as running a race. He sees the goal. He sees the finish line, and he's not looking back, because looking back causes him to lose focus on what's in front of him. Looking back causes him to run at a slower pace. Looking back trips him up and won't allow him to keep moving forward towards that goal. Looking back causes you to lose this momentum of focus. His goal was, it's in verse 10 again, the complete knowledge of Jesus Christ, both in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. In short, he wants to be like Jesus. At the end of my life, when I cross the finish line, I want to do it accelerating, and I want to do it in a way that I'm the most like Jesus that I could possibly be. And then he brings me into completion when we reach heaven. We move on past our former successes, past our former failures, towards the end of this race. And in the marathon of the Christian life, you can't focus on how poorly the last couple miles went or how well the last couple miles went. It doesn't do you any good to beat yourself up about how slow you ran the first couple of miles when you still have 20 plus in front of you. Get your head on, focus, and press on towards the finish line. That's what Paul's calling us to. It doesn't matter if you ran it super fast. I could stop at an aid station and put my feet up and just drink Gatorade for a half an hour, but I'm not gonna finish the race. Didn't matter how fast I ran the first 3 miles. Man, I beat my time there. That's incredible. And you just sit there. We press on to greater things. Our past doesn't define our forward momentum. It doesn't help us accomplish anything eternal. We can only, here's what he says, strain forward to what lies ahead because Christ Jesus has made him my own. like Paul, we're constantly to aim towards this heavenly goal. And many of you may have some goals for 2020. I'm not talking about New Year's resolutions. That's like a lame thing that you're going to break on the third day. This is just for gym memberships. They sell all these memberships, and by the second week of January, they're just sitting there counting all of their money that you've given them and will never use. That's what gym memberships are for. I'm talking about actual goals. I'm going to set a realistic goal, not like, I'm going to go work out 7 days a week this week. No, you're not. No, you're not. Set a realistic goal. This is actually something that I would like to accomplish this year. It's realistic. It's measurable. I think I could actually do that. I want to pay off our car loan. I want to save for college, for my kids. I want to fill in the blank. Some goals that you want to set, maybe some fitness goals. Maybe there are some. I want to run a marathon with Jeff. I would love for any of you to run a stupid marathon with me. I actually have a Harvest team with World Vision. I would love for you to join me. It doesn't matter how fast you run or if you think running is stupid, because so do I. You can talk with me afterwards. But you could have a fitness goal. I'm going to get in better shape. I'm going to lose this many pounds by the end of the year. But set a realistic goal, not just this, like, I'm going to work out forever. Setting a fitness goal. Maybe you've got some financial goals. You want to pay off something. You want to save for something. You want to go on a trip in the summer to wherever and save for that. Maybe there's some family goals. You know what? I really want us to get back to God's word together as a family. And so once a week, we're going to spend time as a family getting into God's word. Whatever that goal is, setting some goals, some career goals. I really want to accomplish this. I want to make 3 sales in the first quarter. And that's a big goal, but I think I can do it. Whatever those are, your personal growth goals. I want to be more loving of a person. I want to be the person who just immediately, I'm just more loving. And so to do that, I'm going to set up these steps so that I can measure these things and grow in my love to other people. And then finally, and obviously the most important, is our walk with Christ goals. What are your spiritual growth goals? What are some things you want to do this year to grow, to keep moving forward in your maturity of Christ? Now, I'm not talking about I want to pray more, because every person in this room says I want to pray more. What I mean is something specific, like I'm going to get up 3 days a week at 5:30, whatever time, and I'm going to spend 30 minutes in prayer. Setting a really specific, measurable, realistic goal for yourself so that you can grow this next year. We need to be intentional about this. And most of you, when you're at your job, you're thinking about, how am I going to accomplish that sale? How am I going to do this? But then when we get to our Christian walk, we're like, I'm going to pray more. Of course you do. Like, set some really specific goals. We're going to work on this in a few minutes. I'm going to ask you to take a couple minutes to pray about this and to write it down on your notes there. What is your specific personal spiritual growth goal for this next year of how you can keep moving forward? We don't need to look behind us. We only need to set our eyes on the author, the perfect author and perfecter of our faith, Jesus Christ. Because when he's our goal, when we're focused on being like Jesus, we can see these elements that we need to grow in. And we can put these things into practice. It's time to stop letting our past determine our future. Move forward toward the goal. And thirdly, move forward to mature thinking. Move forward to mature thinking. He says in verse 15, let those of us who are mature think this way. And if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that to you also. Only let us hold true to what we have attained. When he says think this way, he's talking about not just having the thought one time. You should think about this. He's saying this should be your pattern of thinking, your ongoing mindset of chasing after the goal. That no matter what is in the past of the race, I'm looking at the finish line. I'm working on pressing on in maturity to grow in that. And I love, he essentially says here, if you're really mature, you'll recognize that you're not mature. That's actually what he's saying here. And it's like the further I come in my relationship with Jesus, the more I realize how far it really is to reach perfection of what Jesus Christ is like. I think when we're beginning in our Christian walk, we think, yeah, I got to do this and this and this, and like those three things, and then I'm good, and then I'm just like Jesus, right? But then the more and more you grow and learn, and the more life gets in your way, the more you realize that I've fallen, I've stumbled in some ways, and God's shown me some of these lessons throughout my life, the more I realize that finish line is pretty far away. We've got a long way to go. It is a marathon. It's not a 5K. We need to press on so that we can have greater growth, a greater maturity in this. And I love how he says, if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that to you also. I mean, it's kind of funny, you know? You're like, God's going to show you you're wrong. That's kind of what he said. But the more and more I read this, I was like, that's a picture of maturity. He doesn't say, like, this is the Apostle Paul. We don't have apostles anymore, just so you know. But like, if anyone could say, listen, you're wrong, I'm right, just do what you're told. Paul could have done that. He could have. He was an apostle. No one else in this room can do that because you're not an apostle, just to be clear, okay? So, but Paul could have done that, but he doesn't do that. He leaves it with the Lord. Immaturity says, you must think exactly like me, and it's my job to convince you that you're wrong and I'm right. Maturity says, I'm going to leave that with the Lord. I'm not going to fight with another believer over something small. I'm just going to leave it with the Lord. And that is something that all of us need to learn this year. Just going to leave that with the Lord. I'm not going to spend my time, my energy trying to argue with somebody when they don't believe something else. I'm going to speak the truth to them, and then I'm just going to leave it. I'm going to leave that with the Lord. I trust the Lord with all of that. That's something all of us could grow in maturity in this year. As we move forward in maturity, Paul then says in verse 16, only let us hold true to what we have attained. You see, he doesn't want us to miss the fact that he's back at the very beginning of our message, that he's not saying forget everything. He's just saying don't let that hinder you. But instead, he says hold on to what you've attained. Hold true to the things that you've already learned. The lessons that God has taught you this year, hold on to those things. I don't want another 2019. I don't want to have to relearn the things that I've learned this year. I'm going to remember those things because I don't want God to have to teach me those things again. So hold on to what you've attained, those lessons, those growth points when you've been like, man, the Lord has been faithfulness and I've learned to trust him more and I've learned to not stress over it. I've learned to take it quickly to him in prayer. I've learned to be loving to others even when I'm hurt. All of these lessons that you have learned and more, hold on to those things. Hold true to what you have attained. Part of mature thinking is holding on to what you've learned in the Lord, not to fall back into these patterns, these lessons that God has already taught us, not to turn back from the progress we've already made, but to live a life worthy of the gospel. Paul's desire for himself and for us is that we would hold true to what we've attained and that we would press on to greater depths in our relationship with the Lord, to keep moving forward. One Christmas present that I received from my wife that I was really grateful for is a frame, like an art print of this prayer by Sir Francis Drake. He was a 16th century sea captain and became a pirate and some things like that. So I wouldn't condone everything that he's done, but he's really written some pretty incredible prayers. He's a believer and he's written this pretty famous prayer that has inspired many. And he says, "Disturb us, Lord, when we are too well pleased with ourselves, when our dreams have come true because we've dreamed too little, when we have arrived in safety because we sailed too close to the shore. Disturb us, Lord, when with the abundance of things we possess, we have lost our thirst for the waters of life. Having fallen in love with life, we have ceased to dream of eternity. And in our efforts to build a new earth, we have allowed our vision of the new heaven to dim. Disturb us, Lord, to dare more boldly, to venture on wilder seas where storms will show your mastery. Where losing sight of land, we shall find the stars. We ask you to push back the horizons of our hopes and to push into the future in strength, in courage, in hope, and in love. He prays, we need to be disturbed more. We need to be moved forward. We need to be pressing on to greater things, to keep moving forward, not limited by what has been in the past, not content with where we are, but pressing on to greater growth in our lives with Christ. We move forward to live our lives up to the standards of what Jesus Christ has modeled and what God has called you and me to be, and that's holy and righteous. And we do that by setting some specific spiritual growth goals to press on. We don't do that aimlessly, but we do that with a goal in mind. So I'm going to give you 2 minutes right now. And I want to take a couple of minutes. Take some time. Just pray silently to the Lord. And I want you to come up with something specific. A specific spiritual growth goal. The more specific you are, the more likely you are to actually try for that. So this is just between you and the Lord. I'm not going to make you come up here and say it. But take a couple moments, and then we'll pray together. Have written down my spiritual growth goal for 2020 is. Because for each of us, our spiritual growth goal for 2020 is to be more like Jesus. So it's right for us to take elements of that goal and to set a specific goal for the year, that this is what I'm going to press on to. This is the maturity that I'm going for this year, to help me grow in maturity, to keep moving forward in our walk with the Lord. I want to pray for each one of you. If you're comfortable, you can grab your notes, your piece of paper, and maybe hold it up to the Lord. Or if it's easier for you, if it's on your phone, you can just hold your hands up. Let's just let this be a symbol to the Lord that we're giving all of this to you, Lord, that we need your help in all of this. And Father, we ask that you would take these goals that we've set, that you would take this intentional thought that we have put down. Lord, we submit it all to your will. God, we pray that your will would be done this year in 2020. We pray for greater growth for each of us. God, I pray for each brother and each sister who has their hands raised, who's lifting these things up to you, Lord. You are the author and perfecter of us, Lord. God, we thank you for the image, the perfect picture of Jesus Christ of completion. And God, we run that race towards you. And so we would pray, Lord, that you would give us strength this year. Help us to tie our shoes tight and to run fast for you, Lord. That we wouldn't be focused on what's behind us, that we wouldn't lose focus or lose our pace because of what has happened in the past. Lord, let not our past victories, our past failures, the things that have tripped us up, let those things not determine our future momentum. God, we believe that you are faithful. We believe that you are at work in our lives, and we believe that you have greater things in store for us. We know, Lord, that you are faithful to those who you've called to yourselves. We know that you work everything in our lives for the good of those who love you. And so, God, we place our lives in your hands. We lift them up to you and pray that you would work this year. God, help us to press on to greater maturity. Help us to keep moving forward in our obedience to you. God, we recognize each and every day that we're not there yet, and we're desperately in need of your strength as we run this race of the Christian life. So, God, I pray for each one here. Give them your peace. Give them your strength. Give them, Lord, your endurance to press on this year. God, would we not forget the lessons that you have taught us, but press on to greater maturity? Lord, we want it not just so that we can say we've had a great year, but so we can say we have a great God who's been faithful through it all. Lord, we give it all to you this year. We pray this in the strong name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And amen.